Hi everyone, this is the Enhanced Jail Call prepared by the State Attorney's Office for the Donna Adelson case. Here we go.
Hello, this is a prepaid collect call from an incarcerated individual at the Leon County Jail. This call is not private. It will be recorded and may be monitored. If you believe this should be a private call, please hang up and follow facility instructions to register this number as a private number. To accept charges and consent to this recorded call, press 1.
Thank you for using Securus. You may start the conversation now.
Hey,
yeah,
honey.
Sorry about that.
Now, last thing I heard was you said, and the chief, and then it just went
through. He was supposed to fly. He's the same guy who said he was in a call. Dan back. I first got here and never called him back. But chief's back. He's the chief of the whole jail. Come by and check me out.
So he has not been there yet.
He has not, but the psychologist, PhD, whatever she is, she came by. And I said, listen, I'm fine. I'm getting claustrophobic. I'm used to looking outside of a window, just out into the pod, and this is like, you're sitting in like a
block.
The same kind of cell as I had before, but I could look out the window into the pod. Here, it's like a box. So you can't see, it's a mirror, they can see in and you can't see out.
Is it any help?
Like,
can Dan get this guy to come sooner? Would that be any help?
No, chief back runs the fucking jail. I don't care about what we're calling.
No.
Hey, it's going to come slower.
Well, I'm sure the psychologist thought you were fine, so it's just a matter of waiting for that and waiting for the chief.
Yeah, she says she has a recording for her, and then, tomorrow, and then maybe tomorrow. I got 33% of myself on my phone, and then
Hopefully
in the afternoon. And, it's okay, because once it hits the 15%, so you switch the little battery saver on, and then I can probably get that. But it's like, you just isolate, I'm used to being able to talk to people, move around.
Of course.
Chat on my cell. It's like, you're doing the complete opposite of what I would need to have done
for
this situation.
I know. All right. It sounds like if it's not today, they'll do it tomorrow, but hopefully today. But they're not in a rush, Travis. You're in a rush. They're not in a rush.
It's bad enough all this happened. And now I'm taking it out of my global surroundings.
I know.
What is it, a solitary? I mean, I get why to do it, but this is a bed on a plastic box. I rolled up my mattress upstairs and brought it down here, and it's just my bed sitting in my box, like a 3x6 foot box, put on the ground in the center of the room, so where I'm used to walking back and forth in the middle of the now I just walk up and then around the bed and then back.
And it's the same story with they'll shut off the phones at 4 and not till 6:30 back on. Is that everywhere?
Yeah. And I'm
just checking in. Okay. It's Bree just checking in with me. Okay.
Hey, talk to Dan.
Yeah. Then.
And he's working hard. He's still in Tallahassee. I thought he had left. He's staying here an extra day, I guess, to write up. So whatever it is, if they open up an inquiry, they ask the judge.
Okay.
Good. The investigation came on. He said, listen, it may be the kind of thing that 9 months from now, the juror writes something stupid on a blog and they investigate and they find out, and then they find out something and they're able to open up the open it, and then it could possibly lead to an appeal. You know, I basically got the judge let a lot of stuff in to the case, and he did that because he didn't want them to appeal. You know, the harder the judge rules, I guess there's more appellate issues that can come up, like if that guy, Hankerson or whatever. You know, I guess the harder the judge rules on the issues during the trial, the more likely there's to have an appellate issue. Either the judge is in favor of the defendant, the more likely there's to have an appellate issue.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I do. I do.
So, my general feeling, this is just my feeling, I'm not a lawyer, but my feeling is that he ruled, if anything, he gave us the benefit of the doubt because he didn't want there to be an appellate issue.
Yeah. Is that what Jan thinks?
Well, I mean, he made that comment to me that he the judge ruled in our favor a number of times. You know, he let him bring stuff in. And I either said it or I heard it, that he meant it, that there's not going to be, less things to say that were done wrong. I mean, you have to either say that the judge did something, didn't give you your due process. You know, because you didn't do anything improper, anything improper, like, what's your reason for wanting a new trial?
If there was an appeal, would it have to be in Tallahassee, or can you move it? Because I don't understand why they wouldn't let you move the venue. I don't. It was blatantly, I mean, look, I have, I didn't say this to you before I picked up the phone, but there's a lot of things that we have to do, and we've got a very tight time frame. So one of them involves taking care of some things for Roman, taking care of some things through Steinberg. It's just, Chad's been on the phone all day, and Susan was nice enough when I called her. She said, I'm going to gather everything up, and I'm going to drive down. So she and Rick got here about, I don't know, 10 minutes before you called, so that she could work with us, because we got a couple of hours of stuff to take care of for Roman. So working on that, and a lot, but you're going to be okay. You're going to get out of that stupid room. Once you do, you'll start to feel a little bit better. I know that. And when I have something that I do need to tell you, I'll speak to Dan. Okay? So, then I'll let you know what time to call him. Can you hear me, Troy? Shit. You can't hear me again, right? Charlie, can you hear me? Can you hear me? I'm sorry, the fourth time that they cut the line each time. Okay. They pay for every minute, but they keep charging every time you reconnect. They say that doesn't happen. It's that he's in this room that
they haven't moved.
So the psychologist, they want to make sure he doesn't kill himself. So the psychologist finally came. And he said to her, if you leave me here, I'll kill myself. There's no light, no nothing. I'm in a cement block. At least
let me go back to myself and see where I am. Most of these, please don't leave me here. And spoke to him for a little bit. She said, no, you're perfectly fine. I know that. I just have to go back and, I've got a few of these reports I have to write.
Once I get those written, and then submit them, and then get them approved, you'll be able to go back. So he thought he was going back, in an hour. But that she better get that thing done, because I'll lose my mind in here. It's all mirrored on the inside. All you see is yourself. The lights never
can't even order a drink. Do you want some kind of Coke, a quarter, something?
So I can try to do this. Yes.
That's where I'm going. And thank you very much. I told you.
Because well, I could have won.
When I said
I just got off with Charlie. He's worried about you. He wants to know what. Oh, because I said, yeah. You never. We know you never ask anything about your brother, and she doesn't. And she told me it's because her lawyer said she shouldn't ask.
But we
found out it's not true. But we just got off the phone with him.
My attorney said no, and he asked her attorney. Her attorney said
I never told her that.
But I've never confronted him.
No. So I wrote this last night. We know you never ask anything about your brother. This is 8 o'clock last night. But we just got off the phone with him, and the first thing he asked was, how's Wendy holding up? I didn't have the heart to tell him that you never called us or asked about him. I just said, we weren't up to phone calls right now. Everyone looks to protect you. I bet you've got a lot to think about. But then she didn't answer. But then I got another call from Charlie tonight, and I said, just got off the phone with Charlie. He's worried about you. He wants to know why we didn't speak. I told him a lie. I said, we're only speaking with you and Dan right now. I couldn't bear to tell him the truth. Your sister never even called us, is the truth. So she says this morning, I thought she'd be racing over here last night.
Yeah.
Dear Mom, I know you are upset by the verdict, but the anger directed at me is not justified. I don't know how much anger we don't. I'm not responsible in any way for Charlie's situation. I am not guilty because I did not do anything wrong, and I was not involved in any way with Danny's death. I didn't say she was. When I was interviewed by the police and testified in court, I told the truth, as I was required to do. I cannot control how the prosecutor used my statements at Charlie's trial. Again, I didn't say that. Also, as you know, my lawyer has advised me not to talk to my family or anyone else about the case, which is true. We've never done it. I followed his advice despite your disagreements with this guidance. Please do not text me about this case anymore. Not about the case, is it? Not what I said about her brother and that he wants. How are you, Wendy? How's my sister holding up? She can't. If you have anything further to say about the case, please go through our lawyers. Right now, I have to be singularly focused on taking care of the boys during this difficult time. So I wrote back, okay, we have no desire to speak with you about the case. I guess Dad and I are just shocked that you didn't think of coming to see us or even calling us. We are your parents. We are and have always been there for you and the boys. None of what we wrote matters about the case. That's over. I just want you to know how many times Charlie is asking about you. Not only do you not ask about us, but not one question about Charlie, right? We will need to give you some information shortly, and we need some business assistance. Please let us know if you can be of any help. I have a safe here. I want to give her codes. We're going to be gone. I want her to have all this information. I have the cemetery property. I want her to see all that. I want her to have all these papers and the wills. I want her to see all this. So please let us know if you can be of any help. The other thing is the visa, which she would know about. No, I said we need some business assistance. Please let us know. If not, we'll try to find someone who can help us. This needs an immediate reply so I can start asking other people to help. And then she always gets nervous if we want to talk to her. So I wrote, don't get nervous. Again, nothing, in capital letters, nothing about the case. Just would like to show you some business stuff and personal things. If you can't do it, we must find someone who can. I hope you understand that it has nothing to do with the case. There is no more case. And then I wrote, by the way, you said you have to focus on the boys. Have you told them? So when I got doors before, I said to him, because I was over there last night, I said, well, I asked Wendy, but I haven't got any word from her, so did she tell the boys? And he said, he did. Now, I know Ben was very close. He was writing to Charlie all the time. So I said, how are they? Ben is very quiet. He didn't really talk much. He says, we can kind of face it and say, so he's never coming home. He's never coming back. And so he said, it took him 10 minutes and he was into basketball. I said, fine. He's a child. That's okay. I don't want to see them miserable and upset. That's not my goal. I just want to know how are they. So that's what I said earlier to George, because it was technical stuff that I couldn't do on the computer. And
that my daughter could help me with, but we've been looking it up over and over. Because things change if there is extradition from Vietnam. Because we've looked at all the places. I mean, I could go to Korea and China, but there's no extradition. But we're looking for places where there's no extradition. Who? Really? Good. Maybe she knows about. Maybe she can look up the extradition issue before we waste our time.
Is she going to tell on you that my parents are king and in the country?
My lawyer told us to do that.
Okay, but if you mention it to Wendy, is Wendy going to tell somebody?
Well, you tell her beforehand. I need to tell you something as an attorney who doesn't talk and has nothing to do with the case. It just has to do with Mom and I. And some decisions that we have to make. I know you want to bring her up and show her where everything is. It's a plane crash, no one's going to know where anything is or who belongs to what. So I would like her to come up here so she could see it. I don't think that's asking too much. She can live 3 hours away. Every time she says, can you do this? Can you come here? Can you do this? Everything. How many times do we have plans that I really can't? I have to cancel. Wendy needs us for this. Wendy needs us to babysit. So we've been really good nannies, and I guess our job is up. Because now the boys are older, they can go out with friends, and they can do things on their own. So she doesn't need grandma and grandpa. Okay, pretty hurtful. I have one son that I don't speak with. I have one son who's close to being dead. And my daughter, whom I love, is doing this. I don't get it. I don't get it. I said to Harvey, I swear to God, our family was cursed. Absolutely cursed. And I don't know how to take care of it anymore. So.
My biggest trouble is to say,